And I speak, of course, of the situation in Ukraine. I abhor Russia's brutal and bloody invasion of that nation.
Robert F. Kennedy Jr., you might not agree with everything that he says or professes to believe. I surely don't. I don't think you're going to find any human that you agree with 100% of the time. But when we're talking about a man who's pulling at 16 to 20% within the Democratic primary right now without any debates having even taken place yet, I think it's pretty important to look at what RFK Jr. is saying.
Now, he just tweeted this out. He actually tweeted out an article from antiwar.com. He said, in March 2022, Israeli Prime Minister Naftali Bennett traveled to Moscow to mediate between Putin and Zelensky. He extracted significant concessions from Putin, but then he said the U.S. blocked any deal. War was the plan all along. And that's true. We covered that story on the show not too long ago. It was a really big deal because just like we learned in Istanbul when Boris Johnson came in and nuked those peace agreements, we learned that from Naftali Bennett, the former PM, the same thing happened when Israel tried to negotiate a peace deal. Okay? Now, RFK Jr., he went down and gave a speech today. And this is the best speech I've seen given by any politician, elected or unelected or otherwise, in a very long time. And I want you to watch this, okay?
Where there is war.
I have someone who I really respect send me this.
He'll bring a gentle hand.
Shout out to Daniel for sending this.
To calm and
I watch this,
I'm
like,
guide it towards peace.
Watch this. And you know, this speech started with Dennis Kucinich. Dennis Kucinich, who led the charge for so many admirable efforts, you know, stopping the war in Syria, stopping the Patriot Act, you know. Dennis Kucinich, who is RFK Jr.'s campaign manager, he came out and said that today's June 20th, and the way that
Robert
this
Kennedy
works,
Jr.,
20th,
the light who shines in the darkness of American politics and will lead us to a new day. Thank you very much.
You get the most sunlight, the most physical light, any time during the entirety of the year, June 20th. About that day, we're getting the most sunlight. And he said, a day like today is exactly what we need for the Washington authoritarians in China. They need to have the light shone upon them. Okay, because there's so much darkness entrenched in this deep sleep call that is sending us to war with anyone and everyone that we seek to instill further control.
Thank you.
And I think RFK Jr. explained this brilliantly in this speech. Reminded me a lot of the speech that his uncle gave that we covered on the show just this week at the American University. It was the anniversary of that speech, and he spoke about the need to have a good relation with leaders all across the world, even those that we consider adversaries, okay? My favorite line of this, in this speech, and there were many,
was this right here. RFK Jr. came out and said, FDR met with Stalin, JFK met with Khrushchev, Nixon met with Brezhnev, Reagan met with Gorbachev. Why can't Biden meet with Khrushchev? 50 years ago, this month, my Uncle John F. Kennedy made an historic speech at American University in Washington, D.C. And that speech was called the Peace Speech. I'll give you some of the context. What was happening at that time, the previous autumn, he had been in the Oval Office with his science advisor, who I knew very well as a boy, and growing up as well, Jerome Wisner. At that time, I'm 69 years old, and I remember at that time the regular photographs on the cover of the New York Times and the other papers. Atmospheric testing in the Pacific Atolls, we were seeing mushroom clouds of atom bombs, hydrogen bombs, nitrogen bombs that were going off regularly in that part of the world. And that day, my uncle was meeting with Jerome Wisner and asking him, what happens to the radioactive fallout? And Wisner said it circulates all around the globe very, very quickly and then it drops back into the earth on the rain, and it gets into our fish, our animals, our ponds, our rivers, our streams, our drinking water. And it was raining at that time, and my uncle spent a long time staring out the window, and he said to Wisner, do you think it's in the rain? It's falling right now. And Wisner told him it was. And Ted Sorensen, who was in the room at that time, and who had been with my uncle through some of the most difficult times in his life, mourning the death of his brother, and was with him when he almost died during his back surgery, said that all the years that he knew John Kennedy, there was no time that he saw more trouble than that day.
And that
launched a resolution where he decided he wanted to pay a nuclear atmospheric testing. He knew his State Department would oppose it, and he knew the Pentagon was going to oppose it, so he did the whole thing secretly with Castro. By that time, they had set up hotlines so they could talk directly with each other, but he negotiated the entire treaty through a few trusted aides within the White House, and diplomats who were shuttling back and forth. Under the nose of the State Department, when he finally, they negotiated very, very quickly, and when he announced that the United States, his State Department, and the Pentagon were in revolt, open revolt. In fact, the Pentagon, his Pentagon brass, were lobbying Congress to kill this treaty by their boss, the Commander-in-Chief. And I think something like 80% of Americans initially opposed the treaty. And he was determined to get it passed. And this speech turned the country around. It was the beginning of a process that turned the whole country around. This speech and the whistle tour that followed him, where he went to places where he did not have political support. He went to the South, he went to the Western States, he went like, and gave speeches at the Mormon Tabernacle in Salt Lake, people who had not supported his presidency. But he found tremendous support on the ground from all Americans for making this happen, because as it turns out, the intelligence apparatus and the military brass wanted war, but the American people did not, and they wanted an end to it. And with the speech, he did something extraordinary, something that had never been done before. To me, it's his most important speech, it's one of the most important speeches in American history. And the thing that he did that was so unusual in that speech is he talked to the American people and asked them to put themselves in the shoes of the Russians. Everybody else was doing the opposite at that time. They were demonizing and vilifying the Russians. And he said, no, we have to put ourselves in their shoes, in the shoes of our adversaries.
If you ever imagine Joe Biden coming out and saying something like that, we need to put ourselves in the shoes of the Russians and imagine what they are feeling, what they are thinking, what they are going through? I mean, you ever imagine him? Because that's what he's saying about JFK. Do you ever imagine? Of course not. Never.
And I think so.
We need to do that. It has to be a major discipline. And at that time, most Americans, the zeitgeist, I was born 9 years after the end of World War II, and the zeitgeist were, and the governing assumption was that America had won the war, and now we were going to rightfully dominate peace. And he said something very, very different to Americans, that challenged that patriotic assumption. And he said, no, it was actually the Russians who won the war. They weakened Hitler and made it possible for us to march into Berlin. And he talked about the suffering of the Russians during the war and to legitimize their security concerns, which nobody was doing. Any show of military strength by the Russians at that time was portrayed as aggression. And what he was saying to the Americans is, no, they have legitimate security concerns the same as we do. And we need to understand those things. He reminded Americans of the suffering that the Russians had endured during the war, the unimaginable suffering. 1 in 7 Russians had been killed during the war, too.
He said 27, 28 million Russians. Okay. So when anyone asks, you know, is Russia serious about this war in Ukraine? Are they actually committed? Can they win? Well, there are 27 million people serious in World War II, and they see this as the same exact, very similar threat.
And then imagine, he asked Americans to imagine that all of the lash, all of the cities, all of the towns from the east coast of Chicago had been leveled to rubble, that the forests and fields had been burned. And he said, that's what happened to Russia during the war. That's what they sacrificed for us. And they have legitimate security concerns to make sure that never happens again. And that speech turned around the American people. And they ended up supporting that. It was one of the fastest ratified treaties in American history. I'm speaking to you today because the world is once again at a very similar crossroads. As in my uncle's time, nuclear tensions are at an extreme and dangerous level. As in his time, we have a unique opportunity not only to defuse those tensions, but to take a radically different path, a path towards peace. My uncle's commitment to peace bore fruit in the Limited Detachment Treaty of August 1963. But his assassination that November turned the nation down another path. His successors have launched one war after another, along with the ceaseless expansion of our military. Some call it the Forever War. Americans used to identify herself as a peaceful nation. In fact, our founding, the framers of our Constitution, said that America believed that democracy was inconsistent with an imperium abroad. That if we tried to make ourselves an imperial nation abroad, we would turn into a surveillance state, a garrison state, a security state at home. And that we'd also destroy our economy. We would drain it, as happens with every empire. Every empire ends itself through the expansion of the military, overexpansion of its military abroad. And the founders knew that. John Quincy Adams spoke for all of them when he said, America goes not abroad in search of monsters to destroy. Today, I want to recall that memory, because this forever war, which has so drained our nation's vitality, now threatens to plunge the world into the unspeakable horror of nuclear Armageddon. And I speak, of course, of the situation in Ukraine. I abhor Russia's brutal and bloody invasion of that nation. But we must understand that our government has also contributed to its circumstances through repeated deliberate provocations of Russia going back to the 1990s. Democratic and Republican administrations.
I'm going to say it. He is loads better on this issue. I mean, talk about solution, that's a different thing. Like, talk about the solution to the Ukraine war, that's a different subject. And I even think I have a different opinion on that. But talking about the history of the buildup to what is now in Ukraine, he is scores better above whatever Donald Trump says about, you know, what led to the Ukraine. Trump doesn't know. He doesn't get it. You know, he doesn't understand the history. I think personally, I don't think he does. I think he understands that he wants to end it, and I think he's probably got a pretty good solution, maybe better than RFK's. We'll have to see. I want to hear more from RFK. I mean, his idea of sending a new speakers. Not what I would say is going to, I think that could escalate it quite a bit, but maybe he questions it out more and it gets better, but the analysis of the historical events, he is loads better than Trump's analysis.
Have pushed NATO to Russia's borders, violated our own solemn promise in the early 90s when we pledged that if Russia made this terrible concession of moving 400,000 troops out of East Germany and allowing the unification of Germany under a NATO army, a hostile army, that we would commit that after that we would not move NATO 1 inch to the east. And James Baker gave that assurance, as did the British government officials and many, many others. And yet, today we have surrounded Russia. We have moved it not 1 inch to the east, but 1,000 miles and 14 nations. We have surrounded Russia with missiles and military bases, something that we would never tolerate if the Russians did that to us. And statements from our government officials and think tanks lay out the goals for the Ukraine war. Regime change in Russia, the overthrow of Vladimir Putin. This is what President Biden has said, is there our purpose in the Ukraine. The disabling and exhaustion of the Russian military and the dismembering of the Russian Federation. None of these objectives have anything to do with helping the Ukraine, which of course was the pretext for our involvement in the war. That's when our leaders told us that we were there for a humanitarian mission, but they've since acknowledged that there is a broader geopolitical agenda and that Ukraine is simply a pawn in a proxy war between the United States and Russia. Like teenagers playing World of Warcraft. He's warmongers inside U.S. leadership. Drop war games and scenarios and pretend that a nuclear war is winnable. That is a dangerous lie. It's an illusion that my uncle's defense secretary, Robert McNamara, called mass psychosis. These individuals do not appreciate what John F. Kennedy understood when he said that of nuclear war, quote, all that we have built, all that we have worked for, would be destroyed in the first 24 hours. Even one nuclear explosion spreads radioactivity around the world. Can you imagine the consequence of a full nuclear exchange? President Kennedy did. That's why he said, quote, above all, while defending our own vital interests, nuclear powers must avert those confrontations which bring an adversary to a choice of either humiliating retreat of a nuclear war or a nuclear war. To adopt that kind of course in the nuclear age should be evidence of the bankruptcy of our policy or a collective death wish for humanity.
And you guys realize why the CIA killed him now? His uncle and his father? Because his uncle was saying this stuff at the top of the Cold War, you know? His uncle was saying all the same exact stuff his American University speech 6 years ago this week. And after the American University speech, he even proposed the idea of a joint American-Soviet lunar mission. He wanted peace. RFK was no different. You know, he wanted to avenge his brother, and he also carried a lot of really good ideas. I mean, I think RFK would have made an incredible president of the United States if he was about to win. He won the California primary. He was as if RFK Jr. was already in office. That's why they took him out.
Let me say that again. Nuclear powers must avert those confrontations which bring an adversary to a choice of either humiliating retreat or a nuclear war. None of these the shameful fact is, for the last 20 years, the advocates of militaristic foreign policy within the U.S. leadership have done exactly the opposite. Their belligerent strategy of maximum confrontation extends beyond Russia to China, where the same group within our government hopes to use Taiwan as a geopolitical pawn, the same way they used Iraq and Syria and now Ukraine, to further a vain fantasy of world domination through violent confrontation. Let's leave off geopolitics for a moment. And take the matter of war and peace a little deeper. President Kennedy understood that peace begins with our basic attitudes and beliefs. He spoke of the futility of passively waiting for the other side to become enlightened. We must examine our own attitudes, he said. As individuals and as a nation, our attitude is as essential to theirs. End quote. We should, he said, begin by looking inward. Yes, back in 1963, a politician really said that, a political leader. A political leader voiced what would be considered today a spiritual maximum or a spiritual principle. Let's take up that call from 60 years ago and ask Americans, all of us, to re-examine our attitude. We have been immersed in a foreign policy discourse that is all about adversaries and threats and allies and enemies and domination. We become addicted to comic book good versus evil narratives that erase complexity and blind us to the legitimate motives and the legitimate cultural and economic concerns and the legitimate security concerns of other peoples and other nations. We have internalized and institutionalized a reflex of violence as the response to any and all crises. Everything becomes war. War on drugs, war on terror, war on cancer, war on climate change. This way of thinking predisposes us to wage endless wars abroad, wars and coups and bombs and drones and regime change operations and support for paramilitaries and junta and dictators. None of this has made us safer, and none of it has burnished our leadership or our moral authority. And more importantly, we must ask ourselves, is this really who we are? Is this what we want to be? Is that what American founders envisioned? Here's another spiritual principle, one that my uncles also referred to, when he said, quote, we are both caught up in a vicious and dangerous cycle, with suspicion on one side leading suspicion on the other, and new weapons begetting counterweapons. When we hold others in the belief that they are implacable enemies, they tend to mold themselves accordingly to our view of them. It's a self-fulfilling prophecy or prediction that launches all players into a cycle of suspicion that my uncle warned against. Inhabiting the role of an enemy, we empower hardliners in places like Russia, China, Cuba, and Iran. We invite them into the drama of conflict, the drama of provocation and counter-provocation of weapon and counter-weapon. Is it any wonder that as America has waged violence throughout the world, violence has overtaken us in our own nation?
And I will say, this is 100% the right path to take, not just for reasons of morality, which, I mean, you could argue, whatever. But this is the right reason to take, because if you know anything about the fall of the British Empire, I mean, just copy-paste, that's what's happening to us in a very similar manner, right? The ideologues of free trade, were pursuant of this maximalist, hegemonic mindset that the British Empire was imposing upon the rest of the world. Those who did not bend the knee would be turned into effective slave states. And then, you know, the United States came through, and we had a different approach. We had an approach that was being led by the likes of Henry Kerry, Abraham Lincoln's economic advisor. And Henry Kerry represented a coalition of U.S. leaders, nationalist leaders, that recognized the answer to our economic woes and the lack of development in the rest of the world is not free trade, but instead it's pursuing rigorous development and industrialization with those that we consider friends and enemies. And that's what we did. And that's how Germany became a superpower. Under Bismarck, that's how they became the power, the manufacturing power that it became. You know, they were able to utilize and learn from our technology, our manufacturing capabilities. This is what happened. There's an interesting story a lot of people don't know about, and I was looking at it today. There was an idea, and it's funny, especially in light of the comments this week from Joe Biden about bringing a railroad from the Pacific to the
drones. What did he say? The Pacific to the Indian Ocean, something like that. There was an idea in 1859. The U.S. general proposed that the Tsar of Russia build a rail line to the Pacific Ocean with a gauge to match our new Pacific Railroad. And this was being done by the Kerryites, who were industrializing the rail lines, the nation that was flourishing here of our own country. So, if you follow the path that RFK is warning about, you are going to get the collapse of our empire. If you follow the path of saying, hey, let's invite our adversaries or other countries to the United States and talk, that's what we did. We said, hey, Russia, hey, Germany, hey, Japan. We want to work with you to develop your country. In Japan, when they had their revolution, the Japanese Revolution, the young Japanese revolutionaries who carried out the revolution and instilled the new modern government that led to the demolishing of the feudal society, they were Kerryites. They translated Henry Kerry, the economic advisor for Abraham Lincoln. They translated his ideas of industry and development into Japanese and utilized that as the basis of their new government and their new economic model. I mean, this is the answer. We have strayed so far away from this. Okay, we've strayed so far away from this. We've gone down the path of free trade, exporting all of our manufacturing, and choosing to utilize our military assets to control anyone and everyone within our line of view. And it's just not working. Everything's collapsing.
It has not come as an invasion. It has come from within. Our bombs, our drones, our armies are incapable of stopping the gun violence on our streets and schools, or domestic violence in our homes. I see the same way here as my father and Martin Luther King saw about the Vietnam War. They saw that war. They believed that we could not have warfare abroad without bringing that violence home to our streets, to our attitudes, to our communities. Foreign violence is inseparable from domestic violence. Both are aspects of a basic orientation and a basic set of priorities. Waging endless wars. Waging endless wars abroad, we have neglected the foundation of our own well-being. We have a decaying economic infrastructure. We have a demoralized people, a despairing people. We have toxins in our air and our soil and our water. We have deteriorating mental and physical health. These are the wages of war. What will be? What will be the wages of peace? It will be healing of all the symptoms of America's decline. None of these are beyond our capacity to heal. We can restore America to the awesome vitality of the original Kennedy era. My uncle said it well. He said that no problem with human destiny is beyond human beings. He warned us that, well, too many of us think that peace is impossible. Too many of us think it is unreal. But that is the dangerous and evil belief. It leads to the conclusion that war is inevitable, that mankind is doomed, that we are gripped by forces that we cannot control. We need not accept that fate. Our problems are man-made, and therefore they can be solved by man.
That's from Bill Gates, speech 60 years later from American University.
So how do we actually do that? We started by replacing the vicious cycle of suspicion with a virtuous cycle of trust building. We reversed escalation. It takes courage to make the first move toward peace. Let's see what happens when we stop the provocation and the escalation and offer instead an olive branch. Each step we take invites those who we call our adversaries to take a step further. Maybe Russia won't respond. Maybe they won't respond in kind or anyway. But at least we will know that we tried. And the whole world will know it too. That step comes from a changed attitude and from courage. Speaking in the midst of the Cold War, John Kennedy asked us, quote, not only to see the distorted and desperate view of the other side, not to see conflict as inevitable, accommodation as impossible, and communication as nothing more than exchange of threats. Let's take a moment and allow that to sink in. Today, America has broken off practically all diplomatic contact with Russia. So the communication has indeed become little more than an exchange of threats and insults. FDR met with Stalin. JFK met with Khrushchev. Nixon met with Brezhnev. Reagan met with Gorbachev. Can't Biden meet with Putin? Do we have? Can't we? Or can't we at least begin a conversation? Do we now have such a distorted and desperate view of the other side that we won't even speak to them? To see conflict as inevitable has become the cornerstone of U.S. foreign policy. 2 or 3 decades ago, it was the clash of civilization between Islam and the West. Today, those legions of think tanks that are funded by the defense industry exhort us to prepare for the inevitable war with China. But war is inevitable only if we make it inevitable. The war in Ukraine could have been avoided, even as late as we now know, as spring of 2022, when U.S. officials sent Boris Yeltsin to Kiev to scuttle peace talks between Ukraine and Russia, a peace agreement they had already signed.
Yep.
And not only that, Russia had already begun removing its troops from the Kiev area. We now know this. This war was not inevitable. It was the creation of a relentless mentality of foreign domination. At the height of the Cold War, AFK was willing to see beyond the prevailing stereotypes of Russia and its leader, Khrushchev, as the epitome of evil. The two men, at that time, exchanged 26 highly personal and private emails among each other. We had a Russia, a KGB, a GRU spy, who used to come to my home as a friend. We knew he was a spy, and this was the time that the James Bond held Don't Fall coming out, and we considered it, you know, very romantic and dangerous to have a real spy, Russian spy around. He was a very charming guy. He was very short and extremely strong. And he would do rope climbing contests with my father, and push-up contests, and he could do the Cossack dancing, which was really impressive to all of us, and he taught us to do it. And he had a great sense of humor. He was filled with laughter. My father and mother enjoyed his company a lot. They met him originally at the Russian embassy at a party. But the State Department was horrified that we were letting the KGB's guns buy them our own. During this period, my uncle wanted to talk directly to Khrushchev. The CIA didn't know anything about what was happening in the Kremlin, and they always thought the worst. They always told him the worst was happening. And he knew nothing about politics.
So he learned
not to trust the CIA after Bavis. If you read, if you know anything, the alleged quote, "I want to, smash the CIA into a million pieces and let it blow away with the dust of the wind. That was JFK's quote after the CIA continuously screwed and lied to him about being pigs, number two.
But we knew that if we picked up that phone, we were supposed to stay away from it again. That was the one thing they said, don't ever touch that phone.
My dad, he's a business guy, he met the guy who helped develop that phone, the red phone, like last week. He told me, that's so cool. He met the guy that was involved in developing that phone. He was a young man at the time, very interesting.
But we knew if we picked up that phone, Khrushchev was going to answer. And the wires from that phone are still sticking out of the wall of my brother's house, which was, at that time, was the summer wire. But they knew they had to talk to each other if they were going to save the world. They said, that first letter from Khrushchev, he said, we're all on the ark. And we can't build another one. The earth is an ark, and we need to preserve it. And the question now is, are we willing to do anything like that today? Or are we going to remain stuck in a self-righteous story in which America is categorically good and our opponents are irredeemably evil? If we remain stuck there, so will every other nation. It's not only America that's falling and falling into this good guy, bad guy thinking. That's the example we've set for everybody in the world. No wonder it's been replicated everywhere, between Israel and Iran, between India and Pakistan, between Shia and Sunni, between Jew and Arab, between Hindu and Muslim, left and right, between pro-life and pro-choice, between vax and anti-vax. It's tribalistic, us versus them thinking is tearing us apart. And it's tearing apart our country, and it's tearing apart the world. So, these are the wages of war. But when we take the first step toward peace, we will become once again a true world leader, a moral leader, a moral authority. In our example, it doesn't take much, it's just the first step. And people will start looking at America differently, the way they did when my uncle was president. My uncle, I pointed this out. In my announcement speech, my uncle was so determined, he told one of his best friends, and family said to him, what do you want as your epithet on your gravestone? And he said, he kept the peace. He said, and Bradley asked him to explain that. He said, the primary job of an American president is to keep the country out of war. That's what he said, entering.
I think the primary job of a U.S. president is to protect trans children, trans minors who would like to do gender-conforming surgeries, actually. That's what I think. I think that the primary job of a U.S. president is to ensure... that we refer to them as MAPS because they are a protected minority, and that's what I feel like. This is what I learned with my education at Harvard University. Protect trans kids.
His time in the White House, he was surrounded by military clocks and his intelligence apparatus, his military brass, who were constantly exhorting him to go to war in Laos, in Berlin, in Cuba, in Vietnam, and he never sent a single combat troop abroad during his term in office. They wanted him to send 250,000 combat troops to Vietnam. He ended up sending 16,000 advisors who were not under rules of engagement allowed to participate in combat. That's fewer people, fewer men. And he sent if James Meredith, one black man, into Ole Miss in the University of Mississippi in Jackson.
And it's tearing apart our country.
A month before he died, in October of 1963, he heard that a Green Beret had died in Vietnam, and he asked one of his aides to give him a total casualty list. And the aide came back, and the casualty list had 75 Americans on it who had died in Vietnam. And he said, that's too much. We're not going to have a single more American die. That day, he signed National Security Order 263 that ordered every U.S. Service person home from Vietnam, with the first 1,000 leaving the next month, and beginning in November. He died a month later. And a week after his death, that order was remanded. And President Johnson ended up sending 250,000 troops. President Johnson ended up sending 250,000 troops. Ultimately, 560,000, 56,000 never came home, including my cousin, George Skako, who died in the Tet Offensive. And we killed 1 million Vietnamese. And we've been going off on this path with the military-industrial complex, which President Eisenhower warned about the week before, like 3 days before my uncle took office. He was the best speech that he ever made, one of the most important in history, where he warned America that if we did not take great steps, the pains to avoid the emerging military-industrial complex would devour our democracy and destroy American values. And my uncle knew that speech, and he spent 3 years, his 1,000 days in office, fighting against the rise of the military-industrial complex. After his death, we went down that path that Eisenhower predicted, and that's where we are today. And it's time now to reverse that. It's time. As I said before, peace comes from a changed attitude. At the bottom of the war mentality, that cast the world into a drama of enemies and threats and lies, rise a debased view of human nature. When you see humans as fundamentally selfish, and whole nations as fundamentally evil, then all you have available to change their behavior is threats and bribes. Peace comes from a different place. It starts by seeing within others and within ourselves that which is not selfish, but is brave and generous and idealistic and has good intentions. And I'm not saying that we should ignore the base elements of human nature or the dangers of the world, but if that's all that we see, then we're going to be stuck forever in the mentality of war, and that's where the military-industrial complex wants to keep us. And we will reap forever this poisonous fruits. The chart of course for the future of our nation's military and foreign policy all return once again to the words of John F. Kennedy. He said, quote, "America's weapons are not provocative. They are carefully controlled. They are designed to deter and capable of selective use. Our military forces are committed to peace and disciplined in self-restraint. Our diplomats are instructed to avoid unnecessary irritants and purely rhetorical hostility." End quote. The current administration is going to be in power for another year and a half, but the danger of reckless escalation and nuclear brinksmanship is real and present. I therefore call on our present leadership to adopt President Kennedy's maxims and to start de-escalating right now. I call on them. I call on them to fulfill John F. Kennedy's declaration. I call on the military establishment to exercise disciplined self-restraint. I call upon the State Department to avoid unnecessary irritants and hostile rhetoric. And here's the most important thing of all. I call on every American to join in the new peace movement, to make your voices heard, to reject the insanity of escalation, and to celebrate no longer the wartime president, but a president who keeps the peace. And to what kind of peace do I refer? I'll end with one more piece of wisdom from my uncle.
What kind of peace do we seek? Not a Pax Americana enforced on the world by American weapons of war. Not a piece of the grave or the security of a slave. I'm talking about a genuine peace, the kind of peace that makes life on Earth worth living, the kind that enables people and nations to grow and to hope and to build a better life for their children. Not merely a peace for all men and women, but not merely a peace for our time, but a peace for all time. Thank you all very much.
Yeah, pretty good, but I'm just actually offended that he didn't talk about the struggle of trans minors in the United States. Pretty good, but I'm just this is not right. And you know, we need to defend Peter Hotez from the rogue, authoritarian, anti-science tyrants like Joe Rogan. I'm shocked he didn't speak about that either. Very disappointing. Robert F. Kennedy Jr. Very disappointing. Didn't even speak once about, you know, gender-affirming care. Extremely unsettling. This is a dark moment in American history. It really is. I mean, I didn't even hear him say Black Lives Matter once.
I call on them to fulfill
Did you guys hear him say Black Lives Matter
I
once? I didn't hear it once. Not even once. This
I call
is
upon the
upsetting.
To avoid unnecessary
and I think for
irritants
this,
and hostile rhetoric.
We must cancel Robert
and here's
F. Kennedy
the most important
Jr.
thing of all. I call on every American to join in a new peace movement.
No, on God, that was the best speech I've heard from any politician
and to celebrate no
in a very long time.
And
maybe one of the better speeches I've ever heard from any politician in modern American history. And
And what kind of peace?
I think that, that's a guy, you know, I don't agree with on everything. I have big disagreements with him.
What kind of peace? That's a guy
that could earn a vote. That's a guy who could earn a vote for me.
Not a peace of a slave, or the security of a slave.
Wow, crazy speech. So everyone should watch that. That's why I played it in full for you here. And I'm going to share that. So I'm going to post that as a video. And you should like this video and share it with everyone, because everyone needs to see that speech. Okay? You need to see it. Your parents need to see it. Your siblings need to see it. Your grandma needs to see it. Your ex-girlfriend needs to see it. Everyone needs to see it. So share that video and let's get the truth out to as many people as possible. And hey, he's pulling at 20% right now in the Democratic Party. He has a higher favorability than Donald Trump or Joe Biden amongst the American electorate. Anything could happen. Thanks for watching that episode of The Dive. If you enjoyed what you saw, be sure to drop a like, subscribe, comment below, and be sure to share this video with your friends. Also, my YouTube channel has now been permanently demonetized by YouTube because of the truth that we tell here. For that reason, I'm asking you to join as a supporter on my locals community, which you can find linked below in the description of this video or in the comment section. Thanks for watching. Thank you for your support. I'll see you back here next time.